A Night at the Opera, a poem by Nick Saint-Erne. The following poem tells the events of a chess game played in Paris in 1858 during a performance of Gioachino Rossini's opera, The Barber of Seville. The poem's stanzas in italics I wrote based on the text of the play, The Barber of Seville, or The Useless Precaution, written by Pierre-Augustoin Caron de Beaumarchais in 1775. The Italian composer Gioachino Rossini turned the play into an opera, first performed in Rome in 1816. The players: Paul Morphy, an American chess master; Carl II, Duke of Brunswick, a German nobleman; Le Comte Issoire de Vauvenargues, a French aristocrat. In the opera, Figaro, the Barber of Seville; Count Almaviva, the mysterious admirer of Rosine; Rosine, a young noble lady and ward to Bartolo; Dr. Bartolo, an elderly gentleman who is the guardian of Rosine; Master Basile, Rosine's singing instructor. Introduction. It was November 1858 at the famed opera house in Paris, during the Barber of Seville, that a singular chess game became so famous. The game was played between the chess master, Paul Morphy, and two strong chess amateurs, German noble Carl II, Duke of Brunswick, and Le Comte Issoire de Vauvenargues. Duke Carl and the Count Issoire consulted on the moves together during the game, playing as partners against Paul Morphy, the American who had so much fame. Here is the simultaneous report of the game and the opera performance, with the stanzas in italics below telling the Barber of Seville romance. For those interested readers who know the algebraic chess game notation, here are all the moves of this famous game. You can play it with this information. Prelude. The American chess master Morphy, on his tour of Europe, was wined and dined by the Duke of Brunswick, who longed to play with the greatest chess players he could find. In October, the opera Norma played at the Theatre Italien. After dinner, the play was attended by these two men and Count Issoire, their friend. At the evening's opera performance, in the Duke's private box quite near the stage, they played a game of chess so rowdily that the actors were disturbed and enraged. They were scolded by actors from the stage for their boisterous playing of the game and not listening to the opera. They left the theater that night in shame. Come November, the Barber of Seville was performing at the opera house. The three men were playing at chess again, but this time being quiet as a mouse. Act 1. Scene: the street in front of Dr. Bartolo's house in Seville. The Duke and Count once more challenged the champ to see if they could make up for their loss. As the performance was just beginning, the three men sat in the Duke's private box. Count Almaviva appears on the street in hope of catching a glimpse of Rosine, whom he followed from Madrid to Seville, as she is the fairest maiden he's seen. As the play begins, so does the chess match. The Grand Master makes his move, playing white. First, his king's pawn advances two spaces, attacking the center to start the fight. The black king's pawn, Move to meet the white pawn, is the response played by the noble pair. Flickering candlelight illuminates the chessmen on the wooden board of squares. Up to this point, they have never spoken about her. The Count has just been dreaming, but came to this place to make himself known. Figaro then enters the stage, singing. Make way for the best barber in Seville, making my rounds at the dawn of the day, with razors and combs, lancets and scissors. Listen to the praise my customers say. Bravo, Figaro, lucky Figaro, you're the best barber in all the city. Everybody asks for me, ladies, boys, elderly, and the young maidens so pretty. Oh, Figaro, 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 they call Figaro here, Figaro there, here a wig, there a shave, here a leech. And then they say, ah, Figaro has such care.
Figaro, so what?
Barber in all the city, serving my customers with great delight. And I bring messages between lovers, connecting the young lady with her knight. Lover, why art thou sad and repining? Is it for the love of some buxom lass? Cast away thy sigh, sorrow, and whining. Rather, let's fill to brimming this dry glass. The next to enter is the white king's knight, attacking the black pawn to force its yield. The black queen's pawn then advances one space to protect its friend on the battlefield. The classic moves of Philidor's defense, the duke and the count had pondered over. Chess master François-André Philidor was also an opera composer. Count Almaviva waits near a window in hope of catching a glimpse of Rosine, whom he first saw with awe while in Madrid and came to Seville to make her his queen. Morphy's reply was to bring the queen's pawn all the way to be next to his brother. The nobles next played bishop attacks knight, pinning the knight to the queen, his mother. Figaro continues on down the street, singing this song till he and the count meet. Love and laziness, they each have a part. Both of them share the passions of my heart. I to each one of them his portion gave. No injustice between them can be seen, for though one of them I have made my slave, yet the other one, it is still my queen. If I'm not mistaken, 'tis my friend, the Count. And I believe 'tis that knave Figaro. 'Twas with difficulty that I knew thee, for thou art much in thy bulk increased so. The plot thickens as the battle begins. The white queen's pawn captures the black king's pawn. The black bishop then captures the white knight. And now the player's first blood has been drawn. Pardon, Count Almaviva, but I go. No, rather stay, as I'm waiting here. Two persons talking are less suspicious than one who saunters with no one else near. While below, the two acquaintances talk. At a high window of the house are seen the object of the Count's admiration, Dr. Bartholow and his ward, Rosine. You are always finding fault with this age. Dear Rosine, pardon for my liberty, but what has this age produced? Free thinking, follies, tolerance, electricity. Spying a man she had seen in Madrid was now below her window in Seville, Rosine then drops a piece of sheet music inadvertently from her window sill. Oh, my song is falling out the window while listening to you, Dr. Bartholow. Pray, make haste, run down, save my music sheet, or it will certainly be lost below. While the doctor descends the stairs for it, she asks the man to explain the meaning of why he has followed her to Seville by answering to her query while singing. Morphy's white queen defeats the black bishop. The white pawn dies by the pawn of black's queen. The board center has a queen and two pawns, just like Figaro, the Count, and Rosine. Figaro explains he is their barber and frequently visits the doctor's home. He proposes to help his friend meet her, so the Count answers her question in song. All his fondest hopes have been chased away. He dares adore you whilst he is unknown. But now your will he dreads to disobey, and he pledges his love to you alone. Here your faithful servant shall chant his strain, ever at morn, at noon, at eve, at night. And though his vows to you prove but in vain, your beauty still henceforth shall bless his sight. Rosine appears, singing at her window. Your song has convinced me you are charming. Now, looking at my suitor down below, soft thoughts in my fond heart are alarming. Act 2. Scene in Dr. Bartholow's house later that day. Figaro goes to Dr. Bartholow to provide services as a barber to his household, and he visits Rosine and secretly gets a message from her. Oh, Figaro, I'm so glad to see you. I thank you, ma'am. I hope I find you well. Will you deliver a letter for me? To allow my dear suitor's fears to quell. White moves his king's bishop, angled three squares. Black king's knight moves to attack the white pawn. Morphy's queen aligns with the white bishop. Black's queen moves in front of her king. Lay on. As Figaro sneaks out with the letter, Dr. Bartholow barges in, annoyed. That infernal barber has this hour disabled every servant I employed. He gave a narcotic to my server, a sternutatory to another, and has bled Marcelina in the foot. Figaro's a scoundrel like no other. Even my poor mule has not escaped him. He has clasped a monstrous cataplasm on the only eye the poor beast saw with. Now it twitches like it's in a spasm. The white knight moves twixt his queen and bishop. The noble's queen's bishop's pawn moves up one. And at this point, the game seems quite even. Each player's sides down a piece and a pawn. The doctor confides in his confidant, Master Brazil, Rosine's music teacher. I hope to be married to young Rosine, if you can arrange for us a lawyer. Morphy's queen's bishop attacks the black knight, so the black queen's knight's pawn moves up two squares. Now Morphy's minor pieces are in play. Alas, the count and duke are unaware. Dr. Bartholo says, fetch the lawyer, Basil, and pay him from this large amount. Tomorrow, Rosine and I will be wed before she can learn there exists the count. White's remaining knight captures the knight's pawn, and the black bishop's pawn captures the knight. It now seems the grandmaster is behind, but development and timing beat might. Basil says, now you speak to the purpose. Tomorrow all shall be going your way, but to wed her care must be taken that no one gets access to your ward that day. The count and duke argue over their moves, then mutually decide on a plan. Although Morphy has the initiative, by losing his knight, he is down a man. Act 3, scene, in Dr. Bartolo's house the next day. White's bishop captures the noble's pawn. Check. The duke and count respond with the queen's knight, blocking the attack, protecting the king. At least for now, that knight's move stops the fight. Count Almaviva deceives the doctor. Disguised as Basil's music apprentice, he tells Bartolo that Basil is sick and sent him to replace his attendants. The doctor covets Rosine and so says, oh, pardon me, please pardon me, signor, if I am receiving you with distrust, but I am suspicious of any stranger. Who should I trust? My servants are laid up. Rosine hides in her room in a passion. Some evil genius has certainly turned my house in a topsy-turvy fashion. Disguised as a musician, the count says, make no further apologies, dear sir. Fetch your young ward, and I will continue with the master's music lessons for her. A clever chess move. White castles his king. To the queen's side, the king moves two places. Then the queen's rook hops right over his liege, the only time the king moves two spaces. Black could also castle the king right here, but chooses to move the queen's rook nearby. Next to the king and his knight for support, they are expecting the queen's knight to die. Rosine recognizes the count's disguise. The count plays piano as Rosine sings. Lulled by the music, Bartolo nods off, leaving their thoughts to what the future brings. See the young lovers on the yonder plain. Cupid comes with powerful, pleasing darts. To all of nature, he new life imparts, to the fruits and flowers and lovers' hearts. Whilst she returns her sweetheart's ardent love, with her smile she rewards her suitor's pain. Lovers like these must surely prove to us a guardian's labor is all in vain. For when two hearts are truly joined in one, by Cupid's arrows joined, by Venus blessed, too firm the sacred knot to be undone by all the labor of a jealous breast. The inevitable attack, White's rook, captures the black queen's knight of the nobles. When the black rook takes back and gains a piece, the chess master might be in for troubles. But here, Paul Morphy takes the lead and shows the importance of fast development, getting all of one's pieces into play and removing those of the opponent. Act 4, scene in Dr. Bartolo's house as a thunderstorm rages outside. Master Belize returns and advises against Bartolo's plan for marrying, but Bartolo takes no heed as a judge is on the way to perform the wedding. The last white rook sidles next to his king. The black queen responds to move up one square, where it finally attacks the White Queen. The queens are facing each other. Beware. Then Dr. Bartholo is tricked to leave in spite of thunder and lightning and rain. Once outside of his house, all his great plans for marrying Rosine will be in vain. The White King's bishop swoops to take the rook, putting the Black King once again in check. The Black Knight then captures the White Bishop. Taking with the Queen would lead to a wreck. The Count Almaviva and Figaro enter the doctor's house later that day, planning to make an escape with Rosine, and if possible, spirit her away. Unfortunately, the White Queen travels unto the last rank to check the Black King, and Count Isouard and Duke Carl become sad. They are quite surprised to see such a thing. The judge enters, and the Count persuades him to perform the wedding there with Rosine, and he has him draw up their marriage contract, asking Figaro and Basile to sign. Basile protests, "But if the doctor knew," the Count throws a purse. "Sign as directed." Basile, weighing the purse in his hand, says, "Your weighty arguments are accepted." Since there is nowhere to run for the king, as the White Bishop guards his escape square, and no peace to intercept between them, it looks like he might have a checkmate there. Then Count Isouard and Duke Carl become glad. They see something they think the chess master must have missed. The Black Knight can catch the queen, and thus clutch victory from disaster. Bartholo comes in just after it's signed and makes a futile repudiation, but finally he resigns to his loss and gets her dowry as consolation. Alas for them, these two noble chessmen, for their chess master Morphy understands the immense value of sacrifices during mating combinations he plans. The White King's rook travels to the last rank, surprisingly, right next to the Black King, protected there by the White Bishop. It's checkmate. The Duke and Count saw not a thing. "The truth is," Figaro then says to him, "when love and youth combine for deception of an old man his efforts to prevent, it may well be called useless precaution." Despite the precautions of the nobles, Morphy's piece's rapid development allowed him to win the game even with the loss of his piece's impediment. "In mutual bliss all our days shall pass, and thou, my love, thou shalt be all to me, and as old time shall shake his hourglass, each grain of sand shall bring fresh ecstasy." The two young lovers find their happiness, even though their trysts were met with distress. Which brings us now to our story's ending, the moral: all is fair in love and chess.
La 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 la